بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to our followers, my dear respected brothers in Islam, inshallah ta'ala, what I wanted to share with you today is a story of an amazing companion, of the many companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this companion, as described by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the paradise it longs for him. Yani the paradise can't wait to meet this companion radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He is nicknamed Al-Bahifu Anil Haqiqa. That's his nickname. The one who is the searcher of the truth. He was nicknamed as the searcher of the truth. He has an incredible story in how he began to search for the truth. And this is the story of Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, Salman the Persian, also known as Salman al-Khair, Salman the one full of goodness. And he has an amazing, incredible, remarkable story that even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved his story, to the point where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made him repeat his story in front of the companions, and he repeated it to the companions once again and repeated it before Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, and it's from his chain that this hadith was narrated to us. Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, he left his family, he left his country, he left his town, he left his families and his wealth, he left his properties in search of the truth until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is there where he found the truth. So who is Salman radiallahu anhu and what is his story? You need to pay attention to his story. It's a remarkable, incredible story that is mentioned from these many stories of the companions radiallahu anhum. And I'm going to share with you benefits as we move along with this story, inshallah ta'ala. At the beginning, my brother Salman Farisi radiallahu anhu, he was Persian, Farisi. So in other words, also known as today Iran, that's where he came from. So in other words, he wasn't an Arab. That's definitely, he wasn't an Arab. And that really doesn't matter, because the scale with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't about the lineage of one, or about the wealth and property one owns, nor is it about the beautiful looks that one has, or it's not about the power and the authority that one possesses. Rather, the real scale to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we all know, is the taqwa that one carries in his heart. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in the hadith, that لا فضل لعجمي على عربي, that there is no superiority of an Arab over a non-Arab, and there is no superiority of a non-Arab over an Arab, and also there is no superiority over a red on a black person, nor a black on a red person. And so Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the end of that hadith, he said إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم, that the most honored among you all before Allah azza wa jal is the one who has the most piety and the most taqwa, basically. So you see in the history of Islam, most of the scholars of Islam weren't Arabs. Most of them weren't Arabs, like Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah, Sibawi, which is the great scholar in the Arabic language. He wasn't even an Arab. And you might not know, but most of these scholars as well were also slaves. They were also slaves. It really doesn't matter whether they are a slave or free or black or white or red or Arab or non-Arab. The scale to Allah Azza wa Jal is the taqwa and the piety that one basically carries in his heart. Now, what I want you to focus on in the story of Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu is this. I say to you this, my brothers. Maybe some of you have had stories in how Allah Azza wa Jal guided them to Islam. Each one has a story that if I was to sit with, you might share a long story. And this is eventually how I found the deen. And this is eventually how I began to pray. Everyone has a story. But you need to understand this, that everything you went through, all the trials and the tribulations you went through in search for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then eventually you found Allah, and you found and you became steadfast. Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, he went through everything you went through. Not only that, he went through far lot worse than what you went through. And so if Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, if he found guidance, then it leaves no one else to have an excuse that I didn't find guidance. Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu's story to guidance is an incredible story, that whatever you've gone through is nowhere near what Salman radiallahu anhu went through. For if he was able to find guidance at the end of his life, it doesn't leave anyone with an excuse anymore. And so he had no prophet to guide him. He had no righteous friend to guide him. He had no teacher. He had nothing. He was by himself. And you'll see eventually at the end of the story what exactly happens to him. It's his courage, his determination, and his eagerness to find the truth that got him to where he wanted to go. So the story begins, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says at the beginning of this hadith, and the chain is Hassan, so it's almost يعني صحيح, it's an authentic chain. He said, حدثني سلمان حديثه من فيه فقال. يعني subhanAllah, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said that Salman radiallahu anhu, he narrated unto me his story from his own mouth. يعني in other words, this is as authentic as it gets. I heard it directly from his mouth. Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, I come from Ahl Asbahan. يعني I come from modern day Iran. And I come from a town that is called يعني جيون. جي, that's the town. And the religion of its people, including Salman, his religion and his family and his society, it was Al-Majusiyah. Al-Majusiyah, يعني these are the people who worship the fire. And he says that my father, he was actually a very wealthy man. He had lots of money, lots of property, lots of real estate. He owned empires and gardens and so on. Very rich family. His dad was very rich. And his father, he was Duhqanun Nar. يعني he was in charge of keeping the fire alight. Because part of the religion of the Majus is that the fire cannot extinguish. It needs to remain alight, and so he was responsible for keeping this fire alight, and it cannot turn off. Well, that's their God. How can it turn off? So it's got to stay on. Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, and my father loved me so much. He was the most beloved of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his dad. And intense love, to the point where it is because of the love the father of Salman had for Salman, he did not allow him to leave the house. So he literally imprisoned him in the house and he did not allow him to go anywhere at all and socialize with no one at all. So Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, حَتَّى صِرْتُ قُطْبَانَ النَّارِ or قَاطِبَ النَّارِ, until I became يعني the custodian of the fire. In other words, he became second in charge to make sure that the fire never is extinguished. And to have such a rank, that means you're a high position in society. يعني you're the chief, you're the boss of this guard here to keep it going. يعني سلمان رضي الله عنه, he said, my dad, he owned a massive garden and his father used to take care of it. And so one day, Salman's father got really busy. He was busy with another project. He was working on something else. So he called his son. He said, come here, son. He said, son, I'm getting really busy with a building project that I'm building and constructing. I don't have time to take care of my huge garden. So go instead of me and go take care of it. And Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, so my dad gave me specific instructions of what to do. Salman radiallahu anhu, the next day, he says, I left my house the next day and I was heading towards this garden so I can start work. And this is the first time he leaves the house. He said, as I'm walking towards the garden, I passed by a church. Now, يعني كمان, there is Christianity in the area and that was a commonly followed religion during that time. So he said, as I walked past the church, I heard a noise from inside the people they were praying. He says, وَكُنْتُ لَا أَدْرِي مَا أَمْرُ النَّاسِ يعني لِحَبْسِ أَبِي إِيَّايَ فِي بَيْتِي. He said, and I had no clue what people do. And I had no clue يعني about life, basically life and يعني experience in life and so on. He had no idea about all of this at all because his father had imprisoned him in his house for a very long time. And you know, يعني subhanAllah, you learned something from this. That Salman radiallahu anhu is picking up. This is basically terrible parenting. The father of Salman radiallahu anhu, يعني there are some people like this, that يعني when they raise their children, some people, due to the love they have for their children and due to the concern they have for their children, they don't let them go anywhere and they don't let them socialize with anyone. And they're at home 24/7 and homeschooling and Saturday, Sunday at home and whatever it is, and they don't see anyone at all. And you know, when a kid is like this, at the moment he reaches the age of 15, 16 and 17, he doesn't know anything in life. He's got no life experience whatsoever. يعني if a normal person was to speak to him, some normal conversation, he wouldn't even know how to respond or how to even keep a conversation going. This is something that يعني his father wouldn't teach him this stuff, and the child will never learn this from the father. The child will learn some things from the father and he'll learn a lot of things from society. This is why this is very important, يعني that you understand that you let your children go and leave them in society but have a close eye on them so that the things they learn from the outside are really good things that you might have never been able to teach him. So this was a problem Salman radiallahu anhu faced in his young days because of how his father raised him. He said, radiallahu anhu, he said, I didn't know anything about life. Nothing about Christianity, nothing. يعني I'm walking outside for the first time. فيعني subhanAllah. He said, I passed by this church and I walked in to see what they're doing. So he said, I walked in and I admired their salat and I became passionate about their religion. And I said to myself, يعني والله هذا الدين خير من ديننا. He said, by Allah, their religion is way better than the religion that we are. And so, يعني, why it didn't make sense to him? Salman radiallahu anhu, they're worshipping a fire. And Salman is a man of intellect. He needs to understand logic. So this fire that we're worshipping, how do we ask from it help when it itself asks from us help? Give me more wood so I can stay alive. So how do we, يعني, seek help from a God that needs our help to stay alive? So he goes, this didn't make sense to him at all. And so he said, I love this Christianity, this religion. And it has some sense to that because at least Christianity had some essence in the deen. From among the million errors that are in it, there is some truth in it. So يعني, its essence is coming from the sky. And no doubt about it, Christianity is way better than Al-Majusiyah. So يعني, he felt attached to this deen. And he said, I remained in the church until sunset. And I did not go to the garden to take care of what my dad has said to me. And so as soon as يعني, sunset was happening, he left the church. And before he left the church, he asked one question. He said to them, can I ask you a question? Where is the source of your deen? يعني, look at يعني, how eager and how passionate he is about the truth. He said to them, where is the source of this deen? I'm not satisfied. I need to go to the source itself. So they said to him, the source is في الشام. It is in يعني basically Syria. That is where the source of our deen is. So then he said, I left the church and it was sunset and I left and I walked towards my house until I reached the home and there my father was. And my father had sent after me search parties to locate me because يعني had disrupted his day. He couldn't do anything. He lost his son. And eventually his son يعني rocks up at the door. So he says to him, Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, when I finally arrived to the house and my dad was there, he said to me, son, where were you? Why didn't you do what I told you to do of work on the farm and on the garden? So Salman radiallahu anhu, he says to his father, dad, I passed by a church while the people were praying inside and I loved what I saw and I stayed there until sunset. وشوف subhanAllah, يعني also to teach you something that Salman radiallahu anhu, he knows that his father will get angry. But it seems to be that the father had a very close relationship with his son to the point that the son didn't fear of speaking the truth. يعني he didn't lie. And this is something good that يعني Salman's father is praised for. That he had raised this kid even though he had one bad side. A positive thing for him was that يعني he raised his child and he planted inside of him the seed of trust. That he trusted him. That Salman radiallahu anhu, he knew that his father would get angry, but he didn't speak any lie. He spoke the truth and he says to his dad, look straight out, this is what the case is. I went and I seen their religion and I loved their religion. فيعني subhanAllah, even though يعني, we can learn this from a Majusi man, we can learn this quality that one needs to have a relationship with his son, a really good relationship to the point where the son doesn't lie. Once your son begins to lie at you and you become frustrated and يعني, why are you speaking the truth? You need to know that there was a problem as you raised him. You didn't build that trust with him. For this is an incredible lesson يعني, that we learned. He did not lie to him. So he said, oh father, he says, my father, oh يعني now the father Salman radiallahu anhu, his father, he's saying to him, yes Salman, listen. He said, my son, their deen is no good. And what's the proof that their deen is no good? So listen to his proof. He says to him, the religion of our forefathers is better than their religion. That's it. There was no proof to it at all. يعني that's all he used, these words. It's like he's saying that my father, impossible, he cannot be wrong. And my grandfather, impossible, he cannot be wrong. This didn't settle with Salman. That doesn't, يعني, it doesn't make sense. What do you mean? It's because يعني, your father was upon this deen. That doesn't make sense at all. So he said, سلمان رضي الله عنه said, so my father became really, really worried for me. And so what he did, he put iron shackles on my feet and he locked me in the house once again, this time making sure I can never leave the house. So سلمان رضي الله عنه, he found ways on how to write letters to the church to get it to the priest that was in the church. And he wrote a letter, and he wrote in the letter, O priest, when a caravan arrives to Sham to Syria, let me know so I can prepare myself and I want to go to Sham where the source of this deen is. So, يعني, subhanAllah, he says, a few weeks go by and a caravan from Sham arrives to Iran and it does its trade and you know, it spends a few weeks trading and buying things and so on. And now it's about to leave and going back to Sham. So Salman radiallahu anhu, one night he worked out how to يعني, unshackle himself and get himself out of the iron shackles. And he rushed at night as soon as he got to the caravan. He said, please take me with you to Sham. I need to get to Sham. So they picked him up and they put him with them. And they went all the way to Sham. He sacrificed his family and everything. He left it all in search for the truth. And he began, يعني, he began his journey, this incredible, amazing journey that happened to him. So as soon as he got to Sham, he came down from the caravan and he began to ask the people, where is يعني, the leader? Where is the boss? Where's the priest? Where's the big guy? They said to him, ah, you're looking for the usquf. The usquf is like يعني, what we have imam and mufti. They have the usquf. The usquf is the priest, the highest position in Christianity. So they said, ah, you're looking for the usquf. The usquf, keep going down another 20 kilometers and you'll get to the usquf. فيعني, he journeyed all the way until he reached this usquf. And he said, as soon as I got to this usquf, I said to him, I was told that the source of the Christianity is he, and I want to be your student, and I want to learn from you, and so please take care of me. فذي usquf, he said to him, no worries, my son, come in, you're welcome, sit down, I'll teach you, and so on. And so on the first few days, Salman radiallahu anhu saw nothing but goodness from this usquf. And then يعني, days would go by and this usquf, he'd go out to the people and he'd encourage them to give sadaqah from their gold and their money. And he would pack it all up and he'd treasure it. So Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, I knew this was a bad usquf, really corrupt usquf. I hated him from that moment, but I couldn't say anything. I couldn't walk out to the town and say, hey, your usquf is a liar and is a corrupt person, he's stealing your money, because I've just come new to the town. People will kill me immediately, and this usquf is respected and they come to him for forgiveness on every Sundays, for he's everything for them. So I couldn't do that. So he said, I remained silent and I hated him, but I stayed with him. Until يعني, years went by and this usquf now, he's really old age, حضرته الوفاة, he's preparing for death. And so he sits, he lays down on his deathbed as he's dying. Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Usquf, I came to you for the deen and so on. Can you please guide me and direct me to another Usquf after you die so that I don't, so that I can يعني, keep a bond with my religion? So he says to him, dude, don't worry. The people will choose an Usquf after me and follow him. For he died, this Usquf. He died. And Salman radiallahu anhu, as soon as the people wanted to come and take him and bury him, he came out and he said, oh people, listen, this usquf was a bad and corrupt and a filthy usquf. He used to steal your money and he used to take it and treasure it. They said to him, what is the proof? He said, come follow me, I'll take you to the treasures. So he took him and he dug where يعني, this usquf used to hide the money, and they found 7 qilal min dhahab wa waraq, يعني 7 bags of gold and silver that he had stolen from the people. In يعني, the intention is saying to them, this is for the poor and the orphans, and he'd steal it all. فيعني, subhanAllah, when the people knew that, they said, hey Allah, this was a corrupt usquf. So they grabbed him and they crucified him. He's dead, but because they're burning from the inside, they يعني, crucified him on a tree and they began to pelt him يعني, and they left him there for a while. فيعني, subhanAllah, it is only after it by a few days that the people elected another usquf. And when this usquf يعني, became appointed as the high position of يعني, Christianity in Syria now, he says that I went to this usquf and I said to him, I want to be your student. Please accept me in your inner circle and I want to be your student and learn from you. فالusquf said to him, خلاص, no worries. come and udkhul and sit with me. And so Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, as the days went by, this one was a good usquf. He would not lie to the people. He would not steal from the people. He was righteous. He would pray his prayers. He would give the sadaqat to the people and so on. And I really enjoyed and loved his company. Years went by, and of course this usquf is an old man, because the one that gets a position like this must be like close to death. يعني. This guy also, حضرته الوفاة, he was about to die as well. فسلمان رضي الله عنه, he rushed to him and he said, Ya usquf, I really enjoyed your company and I loved your company and you're about to die. Give me advice, who should I go to after you die? He says, listen my son, there is a top usquf. يعني, I'm trying to think about him, but this is the only guy I think that you can ever go to. And he is in Al-Kufa, in Iraq. So go to Iraq and follow him. And stay with him and tell him that I sent you to him. For a few days went by and this usquf died. As-Salman radiallahu anhu, he spends a few days يعني, searching on how to get to Iraq, يعني, from Syria to Iraq, a few hundreds of kilometers. So then eventually he found a caravan that was taking off to Iraq. And he said to them, please let me go with you. I need to get to someone there in search of the truth, in search of this Christianity. They said, تفضل, come with us. They took Salman radiallahu anhu all the way until they reached the Kufa, Iraq. And it is over there that he went and he looked for this usquf and he found him. And he said to him that I was given يعني, direction from the usquf before that I get to you. He spent with him a couple of years before also this usquf as well. He prepared for death. And as about he was dying, يعني just before he died, Salman radiallahu anhu, he said to him, listen, يعني you were a great man and I was with you for a while. Please direct me to someone that I can continue my يعني, search with and truth with and so on. So he said to him, listen, my son, they're very few in number. يعني يشوف, subhanAllah, the people of righteousness and truth, they're very few in number, even though these are Christians. يعني. He said to him, there's an usquf. And you will find him in Al-Ammuriyah, which is Turkey today. He said, go there and there's an usquf and tell him that I sent you to him. A few days go by and he dies. Where's he going to get to يعني, Turkey now? Anyway, Salman radiallahu anhu spent a while in Iraq. And during this time, he started working. And he owned some cows and he owned some cattle and so on. And he got to the people and he said to them, yani, look, I'll sell you some of it and please carry me and take me all the way to Turkey. For they said to him, no worries, they accepted and they traveled to him all the way until they got to Ammuriyah. When they got to Ammuriyah, a few days he went around and this is his life, that's how he spent his youth. He found this usquf in Ammuriyah. And so he gets to him and he becomes a student of him and he worships with him and he learns with him. A few years go by and this usquf also is dying. And this is the last usquf he's going to meet. So he says to him, ya usquf, please, I have a request before you die. Give me direction, where should I go? He says, listen, my son, there is a man that is going to emerge from the Arab lands. His qualities and his descriptions are in our book. And not a lot of people will tell you about this because a lot of them hid the truth. And I'm going to tell you this truth. And he's a man, go look for him. He's going to merge from the two volcanic rocks where there will be lots of palm trees, yani in Medina. And his qualities are three things. Number one is that he doesn't eat from the sadaqah. Number two is that he eats from the gift. If you gifted him, he'll take. And number three, he has a seal of prophethood between his shoulders. And he said to him, if you catch him, you're going to get to that time. If you catch him, hold on to him and stick with him and that is better for you. A few days go by and this usquf dies and there is no one that is righteous left in that whole peninsula from يعني, Persia to Iraq to Turkey to Iran. There is no one left. Turkey all the way to Medina, that's 2,100 kilometers. This is incredible. How is he going to find his path until he reaches Medina? He says in Turkey he began to work again. Because now you need money, you cannot just go like that for free. So he began to work again and working really hard until, يعني, subhanAllah, he said, I began to own cows, cattle and sheep and I had a whole farm of them. And then one day there was a tribe that was a Meccan tribe. And this Meccan tribe, was going all the way. This tribe was called يعني نفر من كلب. نفر من كلب. The tribe is نفر من كلب. And this tribe, Bani Kalb, they're a Mushrikun tribe, so they're an Arab tribe. They said, or it was known that they were about to head and do that long journey of 2,100 kilometers. So Salman radiallahu anhu found out and he rushed to them. And he said to them, listen, I'll sell you everything I have. See all these cattle and cow and whatever I own. Take it all and just take me to that Arab land with you. Take me with you. Take it all and take me with you. Subhanallah. Yani they said to him, okay, no worries. Give us. They took all his wealth and property and they accepted to take him. And they began the journey and they started going. And the journey began from Turkey. This is the incredible journey for him, radiallahu anhu. As they're going from Turkey, they pass by a place known as Wadi al-Qura, which is about 1,000 kilometers from Medina. And it is there that they wronged him. He said, Hatta al-Zalamuni. The caravan, they oppressed him. They grabbed him. They stopped at Wadi al-Qura. They went down to Wadi al-Qura and they said, we have a slave who wants to buy him. We have a slave who wants to buy him. And so some Jewish man, he came and he said, yeah, I'll buy him. فَاشْتَرَاهُ. This Jewish man, he bought, purchased him. And of course, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the hadith that I am a defender on the day of judgment for a free man who was sold wrongfully. Anyway, now you might have expected that this is the worst day for Salman radiallahu anhu. Yani Salman was a millionaire. Now he's become a slave. Subhanallah, look at the way how Allah Azza wa Jal works and plans everything for Salman radiallahu anhu. Here you would have thought, no doubt about it, this was the worst day of his life. He did not get to Medina. He's now in Wadi al-Qura. He's sold as a slave. He's lost everything. And he still has hope that he'll find the truth. Subhanallah, there is nothing that was standing in front of this man, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, so when I got to Wadi al-Qura, as I was taken by my master now, this Jewish man, as he was taking me to his house, I saw many palm trees. And I hoped that this was the land that يعني Usquf was telling me about, but يعني to my failure it wasn't, because it wasn't the same way the man described it. There was no volcanic rock and there was nothing of that sort. So he said, I spent a few years in Wadi al-Qura with this Jewish man until one day, you know in Medina how there is Banu Qurayza? This is a Jewish tribe in Medina. Until one day, a man from Bani Qurayza came to visit a friend of his in Wadi al-Qura. And just before he left the town, he went to his friend, this Jew who owns Salman, and he said to him, hey, would you sell me this slave of yours? So he said to him, I'll sell you the slave. Allah, yeah, take him, give me money and take him. Wa subhanallah, look how Allah Azza wa Jal is planning for Salman radiallahu anhu to get to Medina. Yani, who sent this Jewish man from Medina? Allah Azza wa Jal sent this Jewish man. For he purchased Salman, and he began to journey with Salman radiallahu anhu until he reached the Medina. And as he got to the outskirts of Medina, Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, yani, I was about to cry because I had seen the city exactly as that Usquf described it to me. There will be two volcanic rocks, Al-Harra, and you would also see lots of palm trees as you go in. And he said, most definitely, this is the city that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would come in. So he said, I went and I got with my Jew and my new master now. He took me straight to his garden and he took me straight to work on the palm trees. And that's what the slave was doing. And it is at that time that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a prophet in Mecca. Yani this is the time now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has become 40 years old and now he has received revelation. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how long did he stay in Mecca? 13 years in Mecca. يعني سلمان رضي الله عنه 13 years in Medina under this يعني Jew as a slave. He's still waiting for the truth رضي الله عنه. For 13 years go by, and of course يعني سلمان, he couldn't go anywhere. He can't go to Mecca and he's a slave. And a slave's life is from the farm to the house, to the farm to the house, to the farm to the house, and you don't see daylight. That's all his job was. 13 years went by. ثم هاجر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى المدينة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, now on his camel, him, Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه, and Abdullah bin Urayqid, which was basically the guide for them that took them all the way through the journey, through the desert, until they reached Medina. They reached Medina, And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he first arrived to Medina, he stopped at Bani Dar Bani Auf, which is basically Quba, Masjid Quba is built. That's where he stopped. And he sat down and he went down there. And this is called Bani Qayla. Bani Qayla is the tribe that is in Quba. So he settled there, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the first day. And a Jew, the cousin of the Jew that owns Salman, the cousin, he comes running to Salman radiallahu anhu, and he comes running to his Jew, his friend, his cousin. And he says to him, ya cousin, he says to him, may Allah destroy Bani Qayla. Yani, why is he saying that? Because Bani Qayla, who are they? Bani Qayla are the Aus wal Khazraj. Yani, they have a long story, but Aus wal Khazraj, they were the people that basically lived in Medina. And there were lots of fights between Bani Aus wal Khazraj, to the point where the wars are known, Harb Bu'ath and so on. Lots of wars. They used to hate each other, kill each other. They were very disunited. So, and who used to keep them disunited? The Jews. The Jews used to get very happy because Aus wal Khazraj were always fighting and disunited. So this Jewish man, he comes running to his cousin and says, may Allah destroy Bani Qayla. They have united again, but now on the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They have united once again, and they're following this man that has just arrived from Mecca today, and they assume he's the Prophet. At that time, when this Jew is speaking to his cousin, Sanbar radiallahu anhu is on top of the palm tree. He's fertilizing the dates and so on. For Sanbar radiallahu anhu, he said, I heard these words, and I was on top of the palm tree, and by Allah, I began to shiver. Yani, he's been waiting for this moment for many years. He says, I began to shiver, and I almost fell from the tree on my master. Almost fell on him, I almost crushed him. Then he said, I came down from the tree very quickly, and I rushed to this Jew, and I said to him, hey, what did you say? Repeat what you said. Then Salman radiallahu anhu, he says, my master got very angry, and he gave me a massive slap on my face. And he said to me, none of your business, until you get back to work, what is it to you? Subhanallah, Salman radiallahu anhu, he got up from the floor, and he says, wallah lik, I just wanted to verify something your cousin says, that's all, nothing else. Anyway, at that same night, Salman radiallahu anhu quickly finished his work on the farm. He was very excited, and he took a tray full of dates, and he headed towards Quba. As he got to Quba, he came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says to him, I have received news that you're a very righteous man, and that these people around you are also good people, and that they are poor and they are in need. And by the way, I have a tray of dates as a sadaqah. Here you go, have it, eat from it. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he pushed it towards his companions and he said to them, eat from it. I didn't eat from it. فسلمان رضي الله عنه, he said, فقلت في نفسي هذه واحدة. That is one. From the three signs, that is one. He did not eat from the sadaqah. He says, a few days went by when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam now finished from Quba, and where is he? He's in Medina now. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is building the masjid. He's arrived to Medina. فجئته بعد. After a few days went by, سلمان رضي الله عنه that day quickly finished from the farm. And that night at sunset, so his master doesn't see him, he picked up another tray of dates and he rushed to Medina where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was. And he said to him, this is a tray, this is a gift of dates. I gifted to you, Ya Rasulullah. He didn't say, Ya Rasulullah, not yet, he doesn't know. So he said, this is a gift. فَجَعَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began to eat and his companions were eating, فَقَالَ فِي نَفْسِي هَاتَانِ اثْنَتَيْنِ. Salman radiallahu anhu, he said, that's two from the three so far, that this man is the right prophet that Allah has sent. A few years went by now, 2 years went by, and Ghazwat Badr took place. And you know, Ghazwat Badr, it was the first major battle in Islam. And the first companion radiallahu anhu to die in that battle after 2 years after that battle was Uthman ibn Maz'un. And he was the first man to be buried in Al-Baqi' in Medina. The first Sahabi to be buried in Al-Baqi' was Uthman ibn Maz'un. To the point where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he kissed Uthman ibn Maz'un radiallahu anhu as he laid there dead. And he began, tears were coming down his cheeks. That's how much he loved Uthman ibn Maz'un radiallahu anhu. But anyway, Now that they had prayed and finished salat on Abdullah, Uthman ibn Maz'un, and they're picking him up and taking him to Baqi' to bury him. Fasalman radiallahu anhu knew about the burial. And he finished his work and he came rushing to the cemetery. And he's seen the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walking in. And he says, فَجَعَلْتُ يعني started walking from behind Rasulullah and walking up and down and trying to, I want to see that mark of prophethood on his back. For he began to, very suspicious, going around and on top of his back and down. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as mentioned in the hadith, he sensed from Salman he's looking for something. فَلَمَّا النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ sat on the grave, يعني just he bent down next to the grave. And النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ on purpose, he dropped his garment from his back. And Salman رضي الله عنه saw that seal on Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم's back. And he says, فَانْكَبَبْتُ عَلَيْهِ وَبَكَيْتُ وَاعْتَنَقْتُهُ. I dropped myself on Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and I hugged him and I began to cry. And he cried and he cried for a very long time. And then النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ he said to him, يعني, what is your story? فسلمان رضي الله عنه mentioned this story to النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم loved this story. فهي said to him, يعني صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, تحول. He said, come over to our place. And please, you need to come over and mention this story again to my companions. I want them to hear this incredible story of one who searched for the truth until 20 years later now he found the truth. فسبحانallah, he said that I went and I began to speak this story to the Sahaba, and that's how I spoke it to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Then, يعني, subhanallah, he's still a slave. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm a slave, and that Jewish يعني, guy that lives there, he's my owner. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, Ya Salman, كاتب مولاك. In Islam, there's something called al-mukatabah. Al-mukatabah is when someone is a slave, he can go to his master and say to his master, hey, what do you want from me to give you that eventually you'll give me my freedom? That's a mukataba. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to him, Salman, go and tell your slave, how much do you want so that you free me? For Salman radiallahu anhu, he went, and you know, يعني, طبعاً, it doesn't need to be said, but this is a Jew he's going to. And يعني, the Jews, أبخلوا عباد الله. They're the most يعني, tight and stingiest of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يعني, to the point where Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَنُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُهُ. Imagine now you're going to a Jew to say to him, how much do you want to free me? يعني, you're going to expect what he's going to put on him. This Jew, he said to him, alright. He said, look, give me 500 palm trees that live. If one of them dies, you're not free. 500 palm trees that live, and also on top of it, 40 coins of gold. A Jew, 40 coins of gold on top of it, subhanallah. فسلمان said, where am I going to get this from? فسلمان رضي الله عنه went to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, he wants 500 palm trees that live and 40 coins on top of that. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, subhanallah, he looked at his companions and he said, أعينوا أخاكم. يلا, everyone get up and help your brother out. أعينوا أخاكم. We شوف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, يعني, as he's always taught the companions, that الله في عون العبد ما كان العبد في عون أخيه, that Allah, he helps his slave as long as the slave helps the brothers, as long as the slave helps other slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They began, Salman رضي الله عنه, he said, huh, this guy went to his farm and picked up five يعني, palm trees. This one went, and يعني, you know, the palm tree, the little baby ones, right? The fasila, they call it. Like if you went to the markets now, you can buy like a little palm tree. You can put it in the back of your car and go and plant it. That's what the Jew wants, little baby ones. He said, Allah was sahaba would go to their farms. Hey, this guy's got 50 with him. This one 20, this one 10, this one 30, this one 5. Until they were 500 palm trees in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Salman, يا Salman, go back to the farm and start digging holes for these 500 palm trees. فسلمان رضي الله عنه, he says, I began to dig with some help of the companions that came also to dig with me. And he says, when you finish digging 500 holes, call me and I'll come and put them with my hand. Don't put them in, don't plant them. Once he finished digging 500 holes, he came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, يا Rasulullah, the holes are ready. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم came, and يعني بيده الشريفة, with his blessed hands, he began to say Bismillah and put one after the other. Why? لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he puts at the hand his barakah, no doubt about it, the tree will live. Remember the condition is that the tree has to live. وسبحان الله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعني he's not planting it for the Jew. The Jews, as the 2 years after, they're going to get kicked out and all killed. But he's planting it for the people of Medina for himself, and they're going to benefit from it. يعني later on, as this, يعني as the tree grows, صلى الله عليه وسلم. This Jew really didn't get anything out of it. Once the trees were finished, then they were planted. Salman رضي الله عنه, he comes back to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says, يا رسول الله, so he wants 40 coins of gold. Days go by, and someone gifts the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم a piece of gold. It looked in the shape of an egg, a piece of gold. Allah, sahabi gave it. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I found this here. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, أين الغلام الفارسي? Where is that Persian kid? Call him. فهي came, سلمان رضي الله عنه, and he said here, give this to your master. سلمان رضي الله عنه, he said, Ya Rasulullah, he wants 40 pieces of gold. He says, بإذن الله, it's equal to 40 pieces. Go and give it to him. فسلمان رضي الله عنه, he went to his master, and he said to him, yeah, take this piece of gold. Anyway, he did his calculations, he weighed it, and he equaled to 40 coins of gold. And he says to him, Allah, ruh, and they are free. فسبحانallah, he went. And Salman رضي الله عنه was free. Salman رضي الله عنه, he missed the battle of Badr, and he missed the battle of Uhud. Why? Because he was a slave. And a slave, there's no يعني, jihad wajib upon them. And then, what was the third battle after that? It was غزوة الخندق. الخندق, غزوة الأحزاب. And it was his idea to dig that trench, رضي الله عنه, in where when they dug it, and the mushrikun of Quraysh and Hawazin and Thaqif and Ghatafat, 32,000 of the disbelievers, they came to fight Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم in Medina. As soon as they arrived there, what's this? First time we've seen something like this. They said, أول مرة تعرف العرب هذا. يعني the Arabs have never ever known of this war tactic in their life. This was the idea of Salman. يعني رضي الله عنه. But let me share with you, my brothers, in very يعني brief in conclusion, very important things that you learn from this Sahabi رضي الله عنه سلمان. Even though he has a bit more يعني got to do with his life in terms of يعني his story with the trench and his story with Abu Darda and other stories يعني that follow. But it's going to be too much. I'm just going to mention with you some points very important. That now that you have the story in your mind, listen to this. My brothers, Salman رضي الله عنه, he had a lot of barriers between him and the truth. The first barrier was the fact that his father imprisoned him. The fact that his father imprisoned him. And yet he never made an excuse that my father or my relatives were a means of me not getting the truth. So that doesn't work for anyone. For if your problem in finding the truth, or anyone you know that his problem in seeking the truth and becoming steadfast in his deen, Wallah, because my dad doesn't let me, my mom doesn't let me. That's a horrible excuse. You cannot use it. Salman رضي الله عنه crossed it and it didn't even bother him 1 second. His second barrier, my brothers, was that Salman رضي الله عنه, between him and the truth is the intense love he had for his family. يعني Salman رضي الله عنه, he loved his family. And he loved the money and he loved his house and يعني he loved the good life that they lived. And not only that, He was going to become Duhqanun now, the one that is in charge. This is the highest rank in society. But even with all of this, he was willing to sacrifice his emotion for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in search of the truth. And what we learn from this, that when you make a decision concerning your deen, be careful that your emotion doesn't get involved. Be careful that your emotion doesn't get involved. How many people do they say, يعني مثلا, Wallahi, I love making quick money. That's why I can't repent. Or someone says, I'm in deep love with this girl, so this is why I cannot repent. يعني when they want to take a decision concerning their deen, they make their emotion discuss and decide how they're going to lead their life with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers would say, Wallah, I love the nightlife and the parties and the zina and the alcohol, and it's because of my close love for all of this, I cannot repent and I cannot يعني, search for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now. With sister, same thing sometimes. Wallah, I'm too scared of the hijab right now. Inshallah, later on I'll repent and wear it. For what we're learning from Salman radiallahu anhu is he did not allow his emotion. He didn't allow his love of money and love of position and love of his family and love of his dad and love of his society. He did not allow the love of all these things to stop him from searching for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He dropped everything for Allah azza wa jalla's sake. In other words, when you take a decision concerning your deen, It needs to be a right decision. Put fear and love and everything else you're attached to on the side and make the right decision towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third barrier that is between Salman and the truth was the easy access of falling into zina. You know, the Majus, part of their deen, and up until this day, is incest. They practice incest. This is part of the deen of the Majus. Look, actually, this is a virtue in their deen, that the father sleeps with the daughter and the mother with the son and brother with sister and so on. This is part of their deen. There's reward in that for them. فَيَعْنِي الشَّهْوَ was open for Salman رضي الله عنه. And even with all of that and all the desires around him, he was willing to cut it and sacrifice it in search of Allah, in search of the truth. Radiallahu anhu. The fourth barrier was his future. Salman radiallahu anhu's future was set. He's living the high life, the good life, high position, qubbanun nar. What else can you get? Yeah, you couldn't get a better life. But even with that, he was willing to sacrifice the good life and the good future to something he has no idea where he's about to end up. But he was willing to do it for the search of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he comes a very great hadith, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in concern of Salman radiallahu anhu. Incredible. This is subhanAllah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salman was sitting in a halaqa once. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he got his hand and he struck the thigh of Salman radiallahu anhu. And he said, لو كان الإيمان عند الثريا لنا له رجال من فارس. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if Iman was at the furthest star, there was people that would still reach it from Faris, and he meant by that Salman رضي الله عنه. Even if Iman was as far as the star is, Salman would have reached it. Subhanallah, he would have made something and got to it. رضي الله تعالى عنه. فيعني when you read the story of Salman, you'll realize that between him and Iman, between him and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wallahi was a distance that is far greater than the distance between us and the star, us and the further star. There was a distance between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, much more than the distance between us and the further star. And even with that, radiallahu anhu, he didn't give up. He lived among Majus and he was imprisoned in his house. And the city he lived in was guarded by Majus. They didn't allow anyone to leave. And then there were Arab Christians around. And then there was a Roman Christians around. And they had guarded the city. And then there was another third line of defense, which were the Arab pagans, the Mushrikun. And then the Jews around. Yani, impossible to get to the truth. But subhanAllah, he was sincere and determined. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala got him to the truth. Between him and Iman, wallah, he was further than what is between us and the furthest star that we can see at night. SubhanAllah, you know what that means? Yani, if I ask you this question, what is the distance, my brother, between you and guidance? And what is the distance between you and the masjid? A few meters. And what is the distance between you and a copy of the Quran to grab it and start reading? Shuf, yani, meters, kilometers maybe, between you and it. Salman radiallahu anhu, between him and the truth, is miles and miles, and he still got to it. Yani, in other words, gives you no excuse to say, yani, and I cannot memorize Quran, I cannot attend the masjid, and I can't attend this lesson and this and that. He marched to Allah Azza wa Jal, he began and he did not look behind him, and Allah Azza wa Jal, yani, got there. And at the end, Salman radiallahu anhu, he arrived because there was no one, because there is no one that is serious about Allah except that Allah Azza wa Jal would allow him to get there. Even in the worst possible ways, he became a slave. And that was part of the plan of Allah, that he becomes a slave to end up in Medina, to end up meeting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two more things I add on this. Add on top of this, which was a barrier between him and the truth, two very important ones. He had no friends. He had no companion, no suhbah, no friends around him. Yani, there was no one to encourage him. No one to encourage him at all. Look at our state. If we don't find someone to motivate us to read Quran, we don't. And if we don't find someone to motivate us to pray at night, we don't pray. And if we don't find yani, a group of 500 boys studying and seeking knowledge, we don't do it. Salman radiallahu anhu, by himself, sometimes some of us, yani, is that my friend is not going to go to the masjid, khalas, I'm not going to go as well, because he didn't go. Salman by himself, no one. And he went these miles and this hardship and these trials and whatever he went through in search of the truth. فَيَعْنِي سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ. And add on top of this, that he had no educator, no teacher, no murabbi, no imam, nothing, no Google, no YouTube, nothing to tell him where the truth is. Yani, he traveled kilometers to get to know some information that you and I would find out in a few seconds of a search. Radiallahu anhu, and no excuse. And why do I mention this as a point? Because how many people nowadays, wallah, I can't read Quran because no teacher took care of me. Or I can't do anything in my deen because no sheikh wants to take care of me. And no sheikh wants to teach me. And I approached this sheikh and this imam more than once and they refused to teach me. And to stay refused to teach me, you're never going to learn anything. Sanbar radiallahu anhu didn't wait for anyone. He kept on going years and years, years in his struggle and his hardship until he found, yani he ran from Persia to Iraq, to Syria, to Turkey, to Wadi al-Qura, and then eventually to Medina, eventually to find someone to teach him the deen, and that was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's another point. Salman radiallahu anhu, his first teacher, that Christian, after a long journey, that teacher, he turned out to be a thief, he turned out to be a corrupt man. And still with that, Salman radiallahu anhu remained patient, remained steadfast, no worries. This guy, I can learn and take from him knowledge. His corruption and his lying and theft, keep it on the side, but I'll take this from him. What do we learn from that? That people nowadays, what happens when they're on their deen? Wallah, I left the deen long time ago because yani, the sheikh used to lie and he used to rip us off. Like Salman radiallahu anhu, even though his first teacher was like that, he stayed there for the knowledge. For he didn't use it as an excuse to deter him from searching the truth. Yani, look at subhanAllah, the story of Salman. Yani, with the life of people now, wallahi, it is the best cure and the best remedy for one to remain yani, firm on his deen. He stayed with him. Usalman radiallahu anhu, yani, this is the last point I mentioned. He would have no doubt about it. He knew that the worst day of his was the day he was sold as a slave. And even with that, look at the ending of the story. It was probably the best day of his life that he became a slave. It was the best day of his life because it was that he became a slave that he ended up in Medina and eventually ending up finding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Yani, in brief, that is the story of Salman radiallahu anhu. There are yani, a couple of points, maybe we'll share them some other time. Yani, always, when one seeks the truth, whatever it is, when one loses or he becomes lazy in his deen, in his iman, remember the story of Salman radiallahu anhu. Remember the story of Salman. It'll give you that courage, it'll give you that motivation. Yani, if you had no one around you, doesn't matter. Salman didn't have anyone and he got there. If you had no teacher, doesn't matter. Salman didn't have anyone and he got there. Whatever happens, the worst day of your life. But even if you are sold as a slave, you shouldn't matter. You should still keep going for the truth because that's the example of Salman radiallahu anhu. He found that truth eventually. And this is why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved him. And this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-jannatu tashtaqu li Salman. That the paradise can't wait to meet Salman radiallahu anhu. In another hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Umirtu. I was commanded to love Salman and three other companions radiyallahu ta'ala anhum wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala abina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.